So I work in Makespace Studios in central London, and I've got a little space for which I mainly use for illustration, but I also do some model making in here, and I try to combine the two as much as possible. But I mainly got the space to work on this book. In terms of illustration, I work fairly simply. I really just work at one desk, mainly in Indian ink and pencil, combine the two. Occasionally, little bits of Photoshop are needed to sort of blend the two together. Most of what I do is black and white, so that works. Those materials are enough. If I need to add colour, I always do it in Photoshop because I'm actually a little bit colourblind. In terms of model making, well, I can only really do small scale model making in here, so it depends what I'm making. These particular models were a combination of modelling clay, silicon mould making, and resin casting on a very small scale. So all I really need for that is a space to make a mess in that I don't need to tidy up right away. The biggest challenge was that neither of us had done. I've done a graphic novel before. I've done little illustrated stories of my own, but they were very short and not very good. So it was learning the form, really, and learning what was possible and the sort of trial and error involved in that, and finding an approach to it that worked for this story, that sort of served the story best. So that was the main challenge, the sort of learning curve of it. And I think just the joy of it is certain moments when you realise you've done something that works, and you read back through it and it's like, actually this is coming together now. Before it was a bit patchy, but now it's I can see this being a book. It's those kind of little moments. There's never a kind of hooray kind of eureka moment. It's just little kind of moments where you realise it might be quite good.
Everything is Teeth started as a bit of short writing that I did about 10 years ago. And it was just a load of memories I have from childhood, vaguely centred around my family in Australia. And the main thing that I was interested in looking at with the memories was sharks, because I've always wanted to write something that was quite shark heavy, and so it started life as just some kind of nostalgic memories, and then when me and Joe decided to do something together, this seemed like a good starting point, and through the process of editing and the pictures in conversation with the words and vice versa, it sort of spread out into something a bit more interesting, I think, and because we worked on it for 6 or 7 years, a lot of stuff happened to both of us during that time, including the death of my father and his long illness. So that sort of seeped into the book for both of us. Joe is a close friend and knows my family well, so I think for both of us there was a darkness that kind of crept in because of that. The character of Evie is me as a sort of 6 to 8 year old, probably, or maybe 9 years old. And it's really to do with, she's quite a mute character. They've all got quite blank expressions, but she's basically just almost like a camera lens. I was in writing the story initially, I really wanted that feeling of me as an observer rather than being involved too much, partly because as a child I was incredibly shy and very, very quiet and tended to blend into the wallpaper, and you know, people would relax around me and carry on. Maybe they were flamboyant enough for my family that they would have done that anyway, but I feel like I witnessed and remembered a lot of my childhood through the sort of actions of my parents and my aunt and uncle. You know, obviously how I look is Joe's decision, and I think it fitted in perfectly with the tone of the writing?
This character? Well, it's my friend Evie, aged around six. And so, yeah, I've known Evie quite a long time, so I had to sort of think about how I was going to present her as a cartoon character. And I don't know, she hasn't complained about it so far. She's quite quiet in this book. She doesn't say a lot. She's very kind of, very much kind of watching rather than joining in, I think, is a key to it. She's just kind of, I don't know, contemplative, I guess is the word.
It's been really interesting collaborating with Joe to make this. It's not a normal thing for a novelist to work with someone else. Normally, I would sort of work on something without showing anyone for 2 to 3 years, if not longer. And it's all my input, whereas this was nice because it was much more of a conversation between both of us. While it is autobiographical, there's obviously moments of fantasy and dreams and that sort of thing. And so we were able to have real conversations in terms of where it should go. And we chucked out a lot of ideas that were pretty fully formed and great, but just didn't work within the story. So it's nice to kind of have a bit of a challenge and set yourself, a task of trying to describe to someone what you want it to look like if it was a picture. You know, that's a really interesting thing to do as a novelist, I think. Having completed the story, I'm really pleased with the feeling of change that it has, that it started off as quite a small story just about my memories. And after the death of my father and his long illness, it sort of took on different notes and much darker notes, but also it sort of made it clear that the whole story really was about my father. Even though he initially seemed like quite a shady character in the background, it kind of brought into relief all those moments that Evie in the book is witnessing, and made them make sense to me outside of the book as well as inside of the book. I think I would tell young Evie that I think I'd probably tell her to relax a bit. But on the whole, I don't know, it kind of, seeing it there makes me much more, this sounds awful, makes me feel much more affectionate towards myself as a young child than I thought I would be. It feels quite true, a lot of it. I think I'd probably tell my brother that things would be all right.